everybody's been removed from their homes because of greedy investors, developers, and because of tourist attractions. There will no longer be any housing for poor people if this were to go through. There will be no place for my children to be, to have legacy and to have history and knowledge. Ever since they got rid of Marcus Bookstore, I knew that I'd be next in line. And a lot of those with me who were born and raised here in San Francisco. And now we're looked upon as vagrants in our own city upon these 1%, the rich, the stolen privileged people. They look at us as if we don't belong here. They look at us as if we are the strangers or as we are just tourists just passing by in a day. But I'm here to tell you that that's all wrong. Nobody sat down and broke bread with me. And where's the equity for the people who are being forced off the land? Where's the love? Where's the justice? And the same for Section 8 are listing to be open in Ku Klux Klan counties like Redding and Suisun County to push us out somewhere that you know we're not welcome and you know we have no idea. Just displacement and it can equal death. What about the poor elder who's been for 50 years? Displacement would equal her death or his death. To come here and to steal the land and to make condos everywhere instead of low-income housing, because affordable housing doesn't mean low-income housing. Affordable housing means affordable at $2,000 or $3,000. That's considered affordable. But what about the low-income families who are working their butts off to try to make a living, who go to school, who go to work? Where's the people just because of the income of this classless situation, this classless city? Where are the families to go? And I am here to say that that's not okay to come and profit off people's pain. It's not okay to come in and give the people a few little crumbs, which is in vouchers that nobody pays. Know how many people accept Section 8? Not hardly nobody. And if you don't get your apartment or require the amount of apartment they give you, then you lose your Section 8 altogether. So where's that guaranteed housing? It's not here. And I'm just here to say I'm fighting for the people along with my comrades. And it's unfortunate that we the only ones that give a damn in this city.
We not there.
That's right.
So, first of all, I want to also say that today on the Board of Supervisors agenda, item number 10 through 23, listed as mortgage housing bonds, are actually the sale of 14 public housing buildings that include elders and children. They state, like my sister said, that there will be no evictions. There'll only be temporary relocation. Yeah. But we as houseless people and poor people have lived in these power trickster lies for years. No, that is a lie. And once we are out, we are all the way out. There is no replacement. If anyone doesn't believe me, look at the lie of Hope 6. It was the same exact story, and almost everybody in those buildings never got back, even though they had right of return agreements. Why? Because there was nowhere to go when they were, quote, temporary relocated. So what we are given is a Section 8 voucher that is actually being dismantled right now by HUD. We just lost over $3 million in the Section 8 program. People are being told that they only have 5 more years on Section 8. These are lies, and people talk about the homeless problem all the time. Well, then stop making us homeless.
That's right.
We have children here from our revolutionary school, Decolonized Academy, which is poor people, black and brown young people, who are learning actual education that is really about their lives and their own liberation. They are housing residents. They are public housing residents who this will directly make their home stay homeless. So I'm going to ask our young people to read a letter that they're going to present to the mayor today and the Board of Supervisors, begging them to not implement RAD. So first of all, Kimo, please read.
Thank you. All right. of Decolonize Academy and members of the Revolutionary Youth Media Education Program, a foreign magazine. We are also children and mothers and fathers and uncles who will become homeless if the rental assistance demonstration RAD program is implemented. As you may know, the promises being made in the Housing Authority and Mayor's Office is that there will be no temporary relocation of our families from our housing, but we know from our extensive research that there is no temporary housing for us to move to. In fact, we will probably be offered a Section 8 voucher, which hardly any landlords will take in today's market, and we will end up getting pushed out of our lifelong home.
Right on, keep moving.
Yes!
As you may know, the promises being made by the Housing Authority, the Mayor's Office, is that there will be only temporary our families from our home. So we know from our speeches that there is no temporary.
In the housing shortage and the predatory manner in which housing is taken away from elders and taken away from families and taken away from people of color. This is a war. This is a battle. And if we don't fight it, and if we don't come out and speak on it and fight for our equity, nobody else will. We are very proud of our youth scholars, our revolutionary youth scholars with Four Magazine. They are directly impacted by these housing policies that have no regard for our humanity, for our future, and for our past and our legacy and our stories of living here in San Francisco. Our youth scholars will go to each supervisor's office today and reaffirm what they have affirmed here at this press conference. Thank you for coming. You all are welcome to come and go on these visits, these supervisor visits, office visits, in support of our children, in support of our scholars who are our future leaders.
There's one more really important fact. One of the things the politicians say, and including the mayor, the biggest one of them all, is that housing authority buildings are in disrepair. And the city has no money to deal with it. Well, that's funny when they have millions of dollars in revenue from Twitter and Facebook and like all of the other tech agents. But no, we have no money to deal with this. So this is a big boom because we need to make our public housing better. Well, guess what? The fact is that in the process of making this big agreement about RAB, they never once asked the tenants who have lived in these buildings for generations, like my sister Nandi, like Kimo's family. Matter of fact, they've lived in there for generations. And that's called equity. And what we put forth as poor peoples of color and indigenous peoples is, guess what? We'd like to self-determine our own future. So why don't you give us an option of taking back the buildings and we will rehab them through a process of what we call community reparations. Now, that's a concept that, of course, the politicians never want to hear because that means that poor people can actually create their own reality. But guess what? We can. In Baltimore, the city fought, and they're still fighting, but 575 tenants got evicted behind this RAD program. In South Carolina, 5,000 people got evicted with temporary relocation promises. Now, the other important fact before we close is that the non-profiteers are all standing there saying, salivating over these big RFPs with all the money they're going to make to help fix up the housing. Well, guess what? That's a form of racketeering because they're making money on the fixing up and the helping and the advocating while they're also helping us once we're homeless from the program. So, no, we're not down with that. We need self-determination as poor people, as African people, as First Nations people. We need to stop this poverty pimping. And that is what this whole day is about. But in the meantime, don't make our families homeless.
That's right.
We're going to close right now. Thank you.
I have a question.
Yes, look out. It's going to end with the
vote. Patience, and it's called La Mission. The mission is for our people to stay and go. The mission is for our people to stay and don't go away. See, because the new conquistadores are here. Developers with pocket full of dreams, can you dare? Impossible. Impossible is not to fight and struggle for our barrios and communities that little by little are disappearing. Aquí estamos y no nos vamos. We are here and we are here to stay. The mission. The mission. The mission is more than a street or avenue. It's a book that narrates the past and the present. The mission. The mission. I remember sitting down on 6th and Mission on the Gente Plaza. I remember the beautiful weekend I spent chopping it out with the others. Oye, hermano, yo soy Latino, as we break the law by sitting side by side. The mission. The mission. The mission. La misión. Aquí estamos. Y no nos vamos.
Yeah.
National conglomerates, the real estate monster developers that don't have to pay the city taxes. But they're on the poor, don't contribute to our economy. Well, for your information, City Call, those that live in public housing work as security guards, they work in retail, they work in offices, in construction, they paint our homes, offices and buildings. They work in the tourism industry and they work in the daycare business. They have disabled children, they have teenage sons and daughters. They get along in wheelchairs. Where are all these multinational families supposed to go? Don't close the door on them, San Francisco. Don't close the doors on them, America. The way this economy is going, we may join them. The public housing units that are any left or in the street, along with the homeless.
Wow, beautiful.
Woo! Yolanda Tatarco.
Beautiful. Another poverty scholar.
Okay, my name is
My name is Steve Seltzer, and I'm with United Public Workers for Action. And we're supporting this because there's a terrorism against homeless, poor people in San Francisco. This government, Ed Lee and the corporations that really run San Francisco are driving working class and poor people out of San Francisco. This is one of the richest cities in the world. There are over 11 billionaires in San Francisco, actually 20 billionaires in San Francisco, and they don't have money for the homeless. You have people dying in the street in San Francisco, sleeping in the street because there are no houses. Actually, the city government is actually trying to drive people from their homes. They're privatizing public housing, and they want to turn it over to developers. That's what the plan is. This is for the speculators, and these nonprofits that they're turning these housing over to, there's no supervision. They're evicting people illegally, and there's no oversight by the city and county of San Francisco. Why aren't they doing oversight? And the reason is that the developers are working with these nonprofits to take over this housing. They're shutting down Park Merced, they're kicking the homeless out of the people who live there, they're raising the rates. We say that the city should belong to the working people, the poor people, the homeless. That's where the city should belong to. Instead, it's for the billionaires. And we need to organize in the labor movement. We have to stop privatization. We have to have a worker and tenant movement to stop the attack. Because they're not only attacking the tenants, they're attacking the nonprofit workers. They refuse to pay them decently, and they're harassing them as well. So this Thursday at noon, there's going to be a rally at 1385 Mission Street at 12 noon against the Conard House, which is another nonprofit which is evicting people illegally. And they're coercing the workers who work for them to lie and to conduct themselves improperly. So this is a systemic problem that really has to do with capitalism. That's what this is all about. Because that's what they're interested in, making more profits for the billionaires in San Francisco, as if they don't have enough. I mean, how many billionaires do you need? They want more. They always want more. And it's on the dead bodies of the people in San Francisco, the poor people, the working people, who can't get health care, who can't get housing. When you're on the street, you die. That's what happens to you. You die. And they know that. They know that. They know that people are dying. They don't give a damn. They don't give a damn. In fact, they're going to shut down even the little houses they have for working people. So we have to stop it. We have to organize. We have to fight fast. Thank you.
Right on.
Yeah, you got me in the mood to testify today.
Yeah.
Give him another hand.
Woo. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, he done brought the thing up. You see, you know, I live over here. I'm from Fillmore. I've been there three generations. My family migrated out here from the South. And, wow, I've seen a lot. I had a beautiful childhood. Then I had freedom fighters around me. And we all stood up, and we had the mothers and the fathers. And then I endured and survived the tragedy of my brother dying on this soil that's being gentrified. My mother dying on this soil that's being gentrified. And I wish to God, you know, even though I wasn't left with a whole bunch of money, but my mom left me with knowledge and common sense and love and compassion for people. That's what she said to me. The greedy ones and all these folks that are leaving us to spare, they gonna have to answer to somebody one day. And they need to answer to us right now in our complex how they're not doing our repairs, how we did go through a bed bug epidemic, and they said the mayor ran out of money, so there ain't no extermination. There was no pest control. We got to pay for our own pest control. Now, and then they say we can't pay for our own repairs since ain't nobody going to fix them. Well, I even asked another question. Well, won't y'all give me the stuff and I do it myself? Can't do that. Well, can I buy it and then get a credit on my next?
hold it before I flush it. Thank you very much, San Francisco. But I've been here three generations, and I work hard, and I pay my dues just like everybody else. But see, I'm always being told there's nothing we can do, because what y'all doing is y'all ghettoizing the property so the investors can come in with their money, and then once they put their money in it, they can call the shots.
Right.
Ain't no more public housing. Ain't none of that. And like I said, they opened up Section 8 listings in the most racist cities in this damn country.
Mm.
What black folks you know want to raise their kids? What Latino folks you know want to raise their kids in Reddit? Where they got a black man hanging in the middle of that goddamn city. Who want to raise, who want people of color want to raise their children? We've been here for three damn generations or more. And it started with the urban development when y'all started putting people out. Like the man said, yeah, y'all got rid of all the tenants that were housing commissions, and you put government workers up in the position. Let's be real. And everybody sitting around worried about the Giants game. I used to work for the Giants, too, but I'm going to tell all my Giants boss that I'm getting kicked out of my damn city. Let's see if somebody do something about that. I ain't going to be able to watch my favorite team. Why? Because I'm getting kicked out of my damn city.
Say
and
that.
Then I come from somewhere else and got to pay $100 just to park.
Right.
I see the extortion. I see the greed. And I see what's happening in my city. Quit cursing my city. This is where I was born. The Victorian houses was beautiful. The communities were beautiful. The people were beautiful. The organic gardens where you can get 10 pounds of potato for 50 cents, that was beautiful. And now I'm seeing everything being destroyed by greed, and you're creating poverty, people on deliverance, and then you have the nerve to lock them up with your sick line law. And so, what it takes is for everybody to come together right now. No more horsing around. We all need to come together. There needs to be an exodus of people here because it's going to affect exodus of people. And this is just the beginning. And in Board Magazine and all the revolutionary brothers and sisters and heroes and shivers out here before us, if we're going to be the first ones to start building that art for our people, that's what we're going to do. Thank you very much.
All right, so we're going to tie up today. We have a red fact sheet that we'd like people to take that you know what actually is going on, not what you're
misplaced hatred, it caused gathered around questioning God, questioning these streets, and questioning ourselves. If only I had it, as we sighed, as the tears fell from our eyes. Not understanding how these streets continue to steal away the lives, you know? Street life, hustle the lives, then take away the souls.
Wow. Right.
Black lives matter.
Black lives been right. Matter, yes, sir.
Victims of police brutality and fatality here in San Francisco. Also Sullivan.
Ashe.
My close friend Bernard Peters was shot 6 times in his back while running.
Ashe.
Renee Robinson.
Ashe.
Alex Nieto.
Ashe.
Ashe.
That's right.
Leonard Michael Cole.
Ashe.
Iris Dealey.
Ashe.
Almakir Lopez.
Ashe.
Randall Philip Duncan.
Ashe.
Dale Wilkerson.
Ashe.
Oliver Lafitte.
Ashe.
Mario
Barber. Come on, y'all. Ashe.
Joshua Smith.
Ashe.
Kenneth Harding Jr.
Ashe.
Now nationwide, Andy Lopez.
Ashe.
Oscar Grant.
Ashe.
Alan Bluford.
Ashe.
Antonio Lopez.
Ashe.
Mike Brown.
Ashe.
Ayanna Stanley Jones.
Ashe.
Tamari Rice.
Ashe.
Cameron Tillman.
Ashe.
Trayvon Martin.
Ashe.
Renisha McBride.
Ashe.
Kimani Gray.
Ashe.
Kendrick McKay.
Ashe.
Evan Jefferson.
Ashe.
Amadou Diallo.
Ashe.
Sean Bell.
Ashe.
Victoria Steen.
Ashe.
Wendell Allen.
Ashe.
Marley Gray.
Ashe.
Tanisha Miller.
Ashe.
Rakia Boyd.
Ashe.
Jonathan Farrell.
Ashe.
Eric Garner.
Ashe.
Walter Scott.
Ashe.
Jaimil Pierce.
Ashe.
Christina Preziani.
Ashe.
Janisha Bonville.
Ashe.
Eric Courtney Harris.
Ashe.
Guadalupe Manzo Ochoa.
Ashe.
David Cassidy. And the millions others that haven't been recorded.
That's
so
right.
Thanks to social media, they've been recorded. But through
yep.
these hundreds of years, there's been millions.
In the past few months, since January, we have accumulated over 6 pages of names of men, women, and children who have been shot and killed at the hands of police. We're going to take the next 30 seconds in respect and hold our silence.
Within the past 14 days of April alone. Isaac Jimenez, Richard Dale Weaver, Mac Long, Donald W. Allen, Jess Leopold, Andrew Crisiero Corona Jr., Gordon Talmadge Kimball, Don O'Neill Smith, Philip Michael Burgess, Mark Smith, Michael Earl Lemon, Roberto Rodriguez, Dexter Bethia, Douglas Faith, Joseph Jeremy Weber, Eric Rose, Tyrell Larson, William J. Dick III, Jared Fawzett, Desmond Willis, Richard August Hanna, Alexander Myers, Ken Cocker, Terrell Beasley, Justus Howell, Paul Anthony Anderson, David Cody Lynch, Walter Scott, Ethan Nall, Christopher A. Previtt, Darren A. Langford, Wayne Brunette, Aaron Marcus Rutledge, Donald J. Hicks, Eric Courtney Harris, Donald Ivy, Robert Washington, John Carr, Jeremy James Anderson, and Philip White. Just in the past 14 days alone, all these people have been murdered at the hands of police. And a big majority of them have not gotten any justice, any justice. So I just wanted to show how many people have been murdered by the police. That's it.
No justice, no peace.
All right. I know, participate in the Millions March, where we marched down Market Street. She was the lead organizer on that march. She's from Bayview Hunters Point, fourth generation, but she organized it through social media, and some of us in San Francisco, not only in San Francisco, in Oakland also. A powerful young sister who I support, and I think is downright awesome, Miss Atisha Brown.
Gentrification is plaguing our neighborhood. We're suffering from joblessness, poverty, mass incarceration. Our children are being suspended from school more rapidly than any other ethnic group in this city. We are gathered here today to hold local and city officials accountable for their actions. We have demands for the city. We're no longer going to be complacent with the way that they treat us. Yeah. We are here. We are the last 3%, but we are here. Yeah. They tried to bury us, but they did not know that we were thieves. In the words of June Jordan, we are the ones that we've been waiting for. There is power in numbers, and the liberation of black people is the liberation of all people. We demand that you stop profiling, targeting, stopping, frisking, and killing black and brown families. We demand of you, San Francisco, that our community review boards are actually effective and have true jurisdiction over the San Francisco Police Department. We want an educational system that exposes the current and historical racism that exists in our society. And we want barriers to learning to be dealt with professionally and compassionately by culturally competent educators. We demand you, in the name of public service, give up 80% of your department budget to refund school libraries, arts programs, and education and after-school enrichment programs. We demand a complete overhaul of the police Bill of Rights. We demand police officers receive leave without pay while under investigation. We demand an end to the bleed-out policy. We demand that you fire all killer cops. We demand the immediate end to the harassment of the homeless. These are our streets, not yours. We demand a stop to all abuse and violence against mentally ill people committed by law enforcement. We demand a stop to all abuse and violence against LGBTQIA people committed by law enforcement. Police Chief Greg Sir's salary is $100,000 more than the average for chiefs across the nation's top 24 biggest cities. We demand that the city budget is redistributed, these funds, for co-ops whose purpose will be to improve the quality of life for oppressed nationalities by building schools, grocery stores, medical facilities, and creating living wage jobs with benefits. We demand a local hiring policy that ensures 50% of the jobs created by new businesses in our communities go to black people and the disenfranchised, especially those who are on probation or on parole.
That have no plan for moving people into long-term employment, and at the end, they have reached their time limit for public assistance. The mayor's development model is to reduce the city's unemployment by forcing the unemployed out of the city. Just as the mayor's economic policies are displacing long-term tenants from their homes, the mayor is using welfare-to-work programs to displace civil servants from their jobs and shrink public sector employment. Not only are people in welfare-to-work programs that are working in a form of indentured servitude, but their very work is reducing their opportunities for long-term employment. We here are campaigning for legislation that will transform welfare-to-work programs into genuine job training programs that provide paths to a living wage job. SEIU Local 1021 is partnering with us in demanding that the city provide training and employment opportunities in permanent civil service positions to unemployed parents in welfare-to-work programs. We are campaigning for economic policies that create jobs for those who already live in the city. Together, we are sending a message to City Hall that it can't solve poverty by pushing out the poor people. Thank you.
Yo, Dorn, if you're here, come on up. he's going to speak on housing, but I just want to say one thing. San Francisco, you say you are not Ferguson, we say you are. The Gini coefficient, which is the measurement of income equality, San Francisco, you measure up to Nigeria. You're next to Rwanda. Here we are, San Francisco, metropolitan, and the inequality between the rich and poor is so vast that we will continue to be poor unless we, the people, demand something different. If we don't demand it, then we will have no say-so. So we got to rise up. We have to stand up and demand what is owed to us here in San Francisco. Is Reverend Dorn available? All right.
Yay.
I represent native San Franciscans, born in San Francisco, educated in San Francisco public schools. I'm a pastor in San Francisco of a church that has provided services for San Francisco for 75 years. I am a civil servant. I am a chaplain for the San Francisco Sheriff's Department. My wife is a crossing guard. I represent what's good in San Francisco. Yet, I am faced with trying to get people hope when I don't have hope myself. The banks, under the cover of night, are continuing to foreclose and evict people from their properties. Ask me how I know. This morning, I received my eviction notice from my property. I have been fighting for 7 years because of a bank error. I don't want to mention no names, but Chase. is behind it all. Why can't I live where I work and provide services? The problem is that I'm an African American. And it's just not undesirable African Americans they don't want in San Francisco. It's not. We're down to 2%. And now I've gotten an eviction notice. Is it because we don't represent enough votes? Or is it because the mayor is more concerned about his relationship with the big banks than he is about protecting San Franciscans who elected him to be in office? What we want, this is the ask. We want, no, we ain't asking, we demand. They say they need time to figure it out. What we demand is a moratorium on eviction and foreclosure until they figure it out. People are continuing to lose their homes while they figure it out. We need something to happen now. Not now, but right now. Black lives do matter.
How are you guys feeling?
color experience in the community negatively affects their health. And we see this through all sorts of disparities. And in addition, when these people go to the clinics and the hospitals, they receive poor treatment and they do not receive as good of care just because of the color of their skin. And so it's sort of a twofold issue. There's the fact that inequality that they experience, that people of color experience in the community, makes them more sick, and then once they are sick, they don't receive as good care. And so we're here to recognize that inequality in the community, as well as in healthcare, is systemic and needs to be addressed. And we're also here to stand in solidarity with the victims of gun violence, because gun violence is a healthcare crisis. It's a healthcare crisis, and it needs to be addressed like a healthcare crisis.
Thank you, Walker.
Yeah.
And we know, as medical students, as healthcare students, in the health field, we need to recognize that Black lives matter. And we need to recognize that we have a role to play, whether it is as providers of care, or to recognize that there is a disparity in the first place. We were just listening to incidents of asthma, and we're listening to how stress from discrimination, from racism, can impact our health care, and it can impact our health. So we are here to say that even though UCSF is on a hill and in our sunset, we need to be down here too. We need to make our voices heard, that we care about these issues. We will not remain silent. And we are here to say white coats for Black lives.
Also, we have a problem in healthcare, which is that people of color are not represented among the doctors and among the researchers solving these problems. And so we need to increase the pipeline and increase the amount of funding available to young students interested in STEM so that they can be the next doctors and the next scientists to solve these problems and to bring these interventions to people who are being discriminated against.
Okay, so our next speaker is going to speak on education, the disparities in education in San Francisco. You have Miss Vanessa Banks of Young Blood Coleman Park. How everybody doing?
Good.
Martin Luther King said, where do we go from here? Are we going to go to community or chaos?
Community.
Community.
Yay.
My name is Vanessa Banks. I am what you call a pipeline to prison candidate because I was born and raised in Hunters Point.
Amen.
In 1974, the San Francisco, the U.S. Education Department put a plan on African Americans and Black faces to not educate us for 100 years. They got some years to go. So what are we going to do? Our children are in danger because our children are living in the Mission and in the Bayview Hunters Point District. Guess what? They're getting teachers that's getting bribed to get their loans cleared to only come and work with our children. And once their loans are cleared, they leave our community. And that is disturbing our children. We are in a state of emergency. If you have children, grandchildren, nieces, and nephews, you better take a stand because they will be followed into a pipeline
My name is Roberto Hernandez, and I'm a native of El Barrio de la Misión. And we are here in solidarity with our black brothers and sisters. So I'm going to give you a little snapshot of what's going on in El Barrio de la Misión. 8,000 Latinos have been evicted from El Barrio de la Misión, while 6,000 white techies have moved in. These 6,000 white techies have the privilege of going to Dolores Park, drinking wine, drinking beer, smoking weed, and the police never fucks with them. These white people called up the police and had Alex Nieto killed. We have had five fires in less than 6 months. 223 people from our barrio are homeless. And now that we're talking about homeless, there are 3,000 children, and the San Francisco superintendent of the school district, 3 weeks ago, I asked him to verify it, and he said there is 3,000 plus children who attend the unified school district who are homeless. Now, you think they're white?
No.
You think they're black?
No.
You think they're brown?
No.
The rents have gone up. Who can afford $5,000 a month today?
No.
Who can afford $1 million to buy a house in San Francisco?
No.
Not you, not me. Not none of us. So 2 years ago, check this out. 2 years ago, we met with Mayor Lee, and we asked him to declare a state of emergency. It's been 2 years, and he still ain't done it. 2 years. We asked him to put a moratorium on evictions, and he still ain't done it. We asked him to put a moratorium on development of any new luxury condos, and he still ain't done it. We need to let today be the beginning, not just go home after today. We need to come back. We are coming back on May 8th at 12 noon. And we're not going to stand in these stairs. We're going inside. May 8th, we're going inside. We're going inside. You feel me? He's a burden. He's a burden. So let me end by saying that every person, every African American, every Latino who's been evicted, we're going to demand that they be given a voucher, and that when the so-called 30,000 new affordable housing is built in San Francisco, African Americans and Latinos be given the right to come back and live in San Francisco.
Will be shut down, and we are not going to allow it to be shut down. So we will just go ahead.
people are worn out, they're tired, and most of them are not on the street, most of them are right and left. So they can just walk out of their offices and go listen to somebody who has money talking about their concerns.
Thank you.
whose time
has come.
Has come.
Amen. Amen.
I am an old man here.
All right.
Good. But I'm not too old and not too weak. But God has given me a brain and a mouth to speak.
Brittany.
And I know that business as usual has been interrupted. But there comes a time when we as the oppressed have to rise up and strike the blow for freedom,
yes,
dignity, respect,
yes, sir,
and equality of opportunity.
Amen.
Speak with me. You are part of a great movement across this country. Dr. Calvin Butts at Abyssinia Church in New York,
sir,
led that congregation to march in New York City, saying that it's time for us,
sir,
to shut down governmental agencies,
corrupt
policymakers, who do not represent the interests of all the people, and all these laws. And we thank God that you come in a dignified, respectful, eloquent, loving way and said to San Francisco, it's time to stop business as usual and let black and brown people have their just due in this city.
Months. Where is
Where's your
meeting?
pockets.
No, he was going.
He was outside, right?
Yeah.
Where are the people who are supposed to be doing this work for us?
Mr. Rain has been working real hard. Don't put his name in there.
Don't put
Mr. Rain's name in there over Tim.
Tomorrow. Oh, wait, he was a human chef.